It is my true pleasure to introduce tonight's speakers, although after his recent media tour, I feel that Jeremy Scahill requires little introduction. Jeremy is the national security correspondent for The Nation magazine. He's a longtime fellow at the Nation Institute, and he's the author of the international bestseller, Blackwater. A really remarkable investigative reporter, he has produced an indispensable work of journalism in Dirty Wars, which was just published last month by Nation Books. I would be remiss if I did not tell you that books will be for sale following the event over here, and Jeremy will be signing. In riveting and haunting detail, Jeremy takes us inside the covert wars that have increasingly defined American foreign policy over the past 10 years. From Afghanistan, Yemen, Somalia, and beyond, he finds that violence without accountability has become the policy of the United States government. To paraphrase our friend Amy Goodman, Jeremy is a reporter who goes to where the silence is. Without his reporting, these stories would simply remain untold. Jeremy will be in conversation tonight with the wonderful Spencer Ackerman. Spencer is the incoming U.S. National Security Editor for The Guardian, and I just learned that he officially started his position today. Prior to this new job, Spencer was at Wired, where he wrote for the national security blog Danger Room. In 2012, while a senior writer for Wired, Spencer won a National Magazine Award for his series on Islamophobia and FBI counterterrorism training. It's an amazing piece of work. But before we bring them out on stage, we're going to show the trailer for the new film Dirty Wars, which Jeremy produced and wrote while working on his book. The film is directed by Rick Rowley. Dirty Wars premiered at Sundance, where it won the Cinematography Award, and it has gone on to win other awards and critical acclaim at festivals all across the country. It opens next Friday, June 7th, and in New York, it will be showing at the IFC Center and Lincoln Plaza. Details about screenings and how to purchase tickets can be found on the website dirtywars.org. Here's the trailer.
Got a strange phone call. Someone from the inside was reaching out to me. Someone close to the heart of the president's elite force.
There are hundreds of covert operations on multiple continents with the full support of the White House.
It's hard to say when this story began.
Greetings from Kabul, Afghanistan.
This was supposed to be the front line in the war on terror.
What's the name of this village out here?
But I knew I was missing the story. There was another war hidden in the shadows. A night raid.
So there's the two men in the guest house were the first people killed. You saw the U.S. forces take the bullets out of the body?
On your face! On your face!
Who were these men that stormed into Dawood's home? And why would they go to such horrifying lengths to cover up their actions?
Air strikes, targeted killings. A lot of it was a questionable legality.
How had a covert unit taken over the largest war on the planet?
Joining us now is Jeremy Scahill.
Jeremy Scahill.
They're dismissing what you've done.
Why are you still alive? Are you paranoid? Now that everything Marr with, oh, he's dead. What happened? He had an accident.
The list of raids read like a map of a hidden war.
The right guys would get targeted, plenty of other times the wrong people would get killed.
Algeria, Indonesia, Thailand, Jordan.
What we have essentially done is created one hell of a hammer. And for the rest of our generation, this force will be continually searching for a nail.
Despite whatever conspiratorial theories, there's nothing to it.
If they are dangerous, if they are too strong, definitely has a missile in his future.
It's important to know when the president can kill an American citizen and when they can.
When you are fighting with enemy, any option is open. No mercy. America knows war. They are war masters.
Please Please welcome Jeremy Scahill and Spencer Ackerman.
This is the actual size of the book.
Thanks, everyone, and welcome to the roast of Jeremy Scahill. When a friend of yours writes a book, you really, really hope that it's mediocre. And particularly when a friend and a colleague of yours writes a book, you hope it's actually bad. Just because there's that little evil, petty part of all of us that that impulse speaks to, especially with me. And I read Dirty Wars with just such a great deal of professional envy, and found by the time I got through the first maybe 20 of its many, many, many pages, that it was impossible to hate. It is, I believe, an instant classic. Jeremy had an excellent idea that I resent and envy him for, which is to tell in a very clear and exceptionally detailed narrative way a secret history of what's actually happened in U.S. foreign policy and geopolitics of the last 12 years, digging so deep into the most secret aspects of the national security apparatus, and doing so informed by a passion and a sense of moral outrage, but first, primarily, and always, as a deep, deep investigative reporter. And it's an enviable achievement. And whether you read the book or not, you should buy it.
I have four of them muxed together, and I'm using it as a dinner table right now. It's a very large piece. Can I just say something about you, Spencer? Is that all right? Is that acceptable?
It's turnabout is fair play. So
yeah, I mean, the first journalist that I read every day on these issues is Spencer Ackerman, and you know, when he was at Danger Room at Wired, and he just left it, there was such a public service that was being provided on that website on issues of military technology, of expanding covert and overt wars, and Spencer is one of the few journalists that can inject humor and random punk rock history into his articles on the drone program. I also want to say that I'm honored that I just saw my hero Amy Goodman walk in down there. Yeah. Yeah, look at the spotlight. Is it? Yeah. You know how I got into journalism is that I was working at a homeless shelter in Washington, D.C., and I was listening to a lot of talk radio. I was taking guys, a lot of veterans, to try to help them fill out their paperwork, and I had hitchhiked across the country and wasn't sure what I was going to do, and I started listening to radio and all sorts of radio, and I heard this woman on the air one day, and she was talking about the rebellion against the dictatorship of Mobutu Sese Seko. And the rebels that were trying to overthrow this U.S.-backed dictator, and I had never heard anything like it. And then she's confronting all of these really nefarious Republican members of Congress, and at the same time being booted out of the White House for asking tough questions of Clinton's press secretary. I was like, who the hell is this person? So I started this this sort of relentless stalking campaign. I would write letters to Amy Goodman saying, you know, if you have a dog, I'll walk your dog, or feed a cat if there's a cat in the scene. And she ultimately had to decide whether to get a restraining order against me or like let me come volunteer, and not in a creepy way, but I started off basically.
It's always good when you have to interject that,
right? as a coffee runner, and I learned journalism as a trade by studying under someone that I think is really the finest generation of our journalists of our generation. So I'm really honored that she's here tonight. And yeah. And it's also strange when you're walking into your event and the first person you run into is Dr. Cornel West, who's here over here. We we've struck a deal that he's going to become my own personal Blackwater. He's going to guard me as I go around the country. So anyway, sorry to hijack your show, Spencer.
Well, let's start out by discussing something in the news right now, which is the dramatic speech that President Obama gave last week about the future of counterterrorism, what happens with targeted killing, what happens with detention. I wanted to get your take on that and whether you thought it bore any resemblance to the reality as you've observed it.
You know, I think we're living in a moment where we have a popular Democratic president who is a constitutional law professor by training and won the Nobel Peace Prize, who has extended or continued or intensified many of the most egregious aspects of the Bush-Cheney, what they called the counterterrorism apparatus. And for 5 years, this man and his colleagues in the White House have solidified assassination as a central component of what's called U.S. national security policy, and have actually tried to normalize it, legalize it, legitimize it. And they've sold this idea, particularly to a lot of liberals, that this is a clean way of waging war, or a cleaner way of waging war, which is one of the reasons why I called the book Dirty Wars, not to be a master of the obvious that there's no such thing as a clean war, but as a pushback on that idea that, you know, that civilians actually aren't being killed in large numbers. They are. We're killing people in pre-crime operations, you know, like Minority Report, where we don't even know the identities of the people that we're targeting in these so-called signature strikes. And so,
what's a signature strike for those who are unfamiliar with the concept?
Well, signature strikes started toward the end of the Bush administration, and there it started in Pakistan, and the CIA identified areas of Pakistan that were targeted areas where anyone who was a military-aged male and was congregating with another group of military-aged males, if they're killed in a drone strike, they are posthumously determined to have been terrorists. You know, it's a really grotesque form of pre-crime. And then under Obama, those signature strikes expanded to Yemen. So we're talking about a policy where people are being hit intentionally, whose identities we don't know, and against whom we don't necessarily have any evidence that they're involved with criminal plots or terrorist plots. And I think, I mean, that to me is really the most egregious aspect of the drone program. And so Obama gives this speech, and he says things like, you know, that the deaths of civilians caused by our strikes are going to haunt me as long as I live, and talked a good game about trying to refine and bring accountability to the program, and suggested that by moving it to the military, there was going to be more accountability. While he's giving this speech in public, his advisors are speaking anonymously to journalists and saying, well, we're gonna actually have to continue the signature strike program. And this could carry on, this sort of undeclared war could carry on for 10 to 20 years, in the words of a Pentagon official. And I think that, you know, what we're seeing is Obama trying to have it both ways. He's trying to portray himself as a more responsible commander-in-chief than President Bush, while at the same time continuing the very policies that he claims to be addressing or bringing under accountability. I mean, it's to quote Sarah Palin, I think it is sort of lipstick on a pig. Mm. And you know, that'll be the only time I'll quote Sarah Palin.
You know, when we talk about the signature strikes, it actually brings up an issue of journalistic tradecraft, which is the responsibility when you write about these subjects to avoid euphemism and to do so rigorously. And one of the things that I struggle with is the beat that we cover, is what to call the program itself. There are lots of names that get thrown around for it that for a variety of reasons aren't really useful. The one that most often you probably see around a lot is targeted killing. Mm. And you've read that phrase so many times, and the fact of signature strikes has just led me to try and avoid using that phrase altogether, because how can you be targeting a person whose identity you don't know?
They also call it crowd killing. Referred to within, you know, in certain military and intelligence circles as crowd killing.
What term do you think is, and of course if you use drones, then you're really talking about the drone program, you're really talking about a platform, a tool to kill people, and not what the actual effort is, and what do you then do with something like the deadly 2009 strike in Yemen that involved a cruise missile and not a drone. So, do you have a term that you tend to use? And also with assassination, not only is that a very loaded term, but also how do you assassinate someone whose identity you don't know? So, what do you struggle with this? Is there a term that you've come to think is stripped of euphemism and still essentially accurate?
Yeah, I mean, I think there are aspects of it that constitute a global assassination program. I mean, there are hit teams. Sometimes they're being piloted. You know, they're piloting the drones from Creech Air Force Base or elsewhere around the United States, and they're waging war on Pakistan or Yemen, and they're going after specific people. I mean, that's very clearly assassination. In the case of the so-called signature strikes or the crowd killing, this is just an aggressive kill program, and they're trying to wage preemptive war against people that may not even be involved with any plots of terrorism. And I mean, it really is grotesque. And if another nation was asserting the right to do what the United States does, I think the U.S. would be wanting them hauled in front of a court. You know, the U.S. doesn't recognize the International Criminal Court because there's American exceptionalism. Our lives are worth more than the lives of other people around the world, and our crimes are always defensible. But if other nations were asserting this very same right to assassinate citizens in countries across the globe, I think it would be viewed as a scandal internationally.
There's a great example of that. A couple weeks ago, a 23-year-old Yemeni activist named Farrell Muslimi testified in front of a Senate Judiciary Subcommittee. And for the first time, a Senate panel, not very many senators attended, but nevertheless, this was an official panel, heard from a Yemeni about what it's like to see the aftermath of your hometown struck with a Hellfire missile fired from a drone. And you could have heard a pin drop in this room. The guy got very emotional, as you would imagine, the effect of this, having on him. And then describing the cultural impact of the drones being constantly above the heads of Yemenis, hearing the buzzing. It doesn't often get talked about, but the engine of a Predator drone is descended from a snowmobile. So this is something that you do actually hear, even from thousands of feet up. And he mentioned how it's gotten to the point of ubiquity, not just in physical reality, but culturally, that when parents are trying to get their misbehaving children to go to bed, he told a Senate panel that they said, "We're going to send the planes after you." I mean, just imagine how grotesque the humanity of that, which you very rarely hear, came really to the fore at that moment. And then Lindsey Graham starts talking to the guy and actually mansplaining to Farah al-Muslimi what it actually is like to live in Yemen, because he heard this from his Yemeni government contacts. And it seemed like, I want to coin the term Graham-splaining for that one, but,
John McCain, when he took his surprise visit to Syria the other day and ends up taking pictures with really unsavory characters, but then goes to Yemen, and there's this great picture of him at a market in Yemen wearing a traditional Jambia dagger, but he's wearing it, it's like some bizarre, awful tip of the hat to hip-hop, but he's got a sagging sort of Jambia belt with his suit, which is a major faux pas in Yemen, like you don't wear it with the suit, but he's, here's awkward John McCain, and the Yemenis are looking at him, and you can tell they can barely contain the laughter at the situation, but the U.S. has, I mean, we have a cartoonish view of Yemen. Mm-hmm. We are totally detached from the reality of what our strikes are doing and the impact they're going to have on stability in those countries, but also our own security. I mean, I believe that we're making more new enemies than we are killing terrorists. And when Farah al-Muslimi, who I know, and I've hung out with him in Yemen and gone to Katshus with him in Yemen, and he's a really upstanding, amazing young man, he's testifying in front of the Senate. And to me, this really captured where the discussion is in this country. He's sitting next to several professors who on any day of the week could walk into the Senate from, probably their offices are within walking distance and testify in front of the U.S. Senate. The overwhelming majority of the questions were to these academics and not to this Yemeni guy whose home village had been bombed 6 days prior to him appearing before the U.S. Senate. I think it's a really strong symbol of how we are not confronting the realities of what our drone strikes are doing in these countries. I mean, I've met with multiple tribal leaders who have no love for al-Qaeda in the south of Yemen who have said to me, you say al-Qaeda is terrorism, we say your drones are terrorism. And it's not that we're pushing people into the al-Qaeda fold, it's that we are taking people who would have no predisposed reason to be against Americans or against the United States and giving them a very legitimate reason to want to hit the U.S.
And to bring it from the level of policy to the reality on the ground, in your work you met a very interesting man named Saleh, I'm going to mess up his name, Bin Farid.
Saleh Bin Farid.
Saleh Bin Farid. Tell us about him.
Yeah, so, I mean, people know the name Anwar al-Awlaki, who was this first American that we know of that was targeted for assassination and ultimately was killed in September of 2011. And Saleh bin Farid is the head of his tribe. He's the head of the Awlak tribe, which is a very powerful tribe based in southern Yemen in the provinces of Shebwa and Abyan. And he was a guy who's a direct descendant of one of the sultans of Saudi Arabia. He's an older man now. And they were expelled when the socialists took power and overthrew the British colonialists in the 1960s in Yemen, and he lived much of his life in exile, and was brought back in the early 1990s by the dictator of Yemen, Ali Abdullah Saleh, who made a deal with these tribal exiled leaders to essentially give him political support from the south, and he's this sort of amazing power broker who. Was the main figure that I talked to about the first airstrike that President Obama ordered on Yemen, which was December 17th, 2009, this cruise missile attack on the Yemeni village of Al-Majla. And I mean, it was the first time that President Obama authorized an attack on Yemen in the beginning of this U.S. bombing campaign. And at the time, the president was told by Admiral William McRaven, who was at the time was the commander of JSOC, the Joint Special Operations Command, this elite all-star team of U.S. Special Operations Forces, that they had discovered this al-Qaeda training camp, and that there was a senior leader of al-Qaeda in Yemen that was residing there, and they had 24 hours to make a decision on it, or they were feared that he might move. And so Obama greenlights the strike, and the U.S. bombs this village. And after that, the Yemeni government issues a press release saying that Yemen's Air Force had conducted strikes against a terrorist training camp in Al-Majla and killed 34 members of Al-Qaeda. And then the U.S. sent a letter of congratulations to the Yemeni dictator on his cooperation in the war on terrorism. Well, what we discovered later from the WikiLeaks cables is that General David Petraeus, who at the time was the CENTCOM commander, had met with Yemen's president and other senior Yemeni officials in Sana'a and had hatched a plot for the U.S. to begin bombing Yemen and to have the Yemeni government take responsibility for the strikes. And that was the opening salvo in a bombing campaign that continues to this day.
This is an amazing cable, by the way. It actually speaks directly to Petraeus and Saleh conspiring about how to both launch the strikes and then how to portray them with this amazing casualness.
And they're joking. I mean, yeah. The deputy prime minister of Yemen is in this meeting with Petraeus and Saleh, and he goes, haha, I just lied to my own parliament and told them that we did the airstrike. And then the president of Yemen says to Petraeus, oh, you just continue to bomb, and we'll say the bombs are ours and not yours. And I mean, this is all laid out there. But the real reason why we knew that was a U.S. Strike is because this great young independent journalist, this Yemeni journalist named Abdullah Haider Shaya, had gone to Al-Majla with Sheikh Saleh bin Farid, this tribal figure that we were talking about before, and he took pictures of the aftermath of this bombing. And I have his photos, and I also have cell phone video and photos that other survivors took. And instead of an al-Qaeda training camp, what you see is a very impoverished Bedouin village. And I mean, I saw some of the most graphic images I've ever seen on that captured on those cell phone videos of the limbs of infants being pulled from the rubble. And Saleh bin Farid, who had gone there, said to me, when we went there, you know, less than 24 hours after it happened, you saw the flesh of goats and sheep and humans. And he said you couldn't tell if it was human meat or the meat of animals. And he actually, this old man, helped to try to put together body parts so they could bury the people. The U.S. in that attack used cruise missiles that were launched from a submarine off the coast of Yemen. They wanted to use drones, but they were all being used in Pakistan at the time for the intensifying drone war there. And they used cluster bombs, which are banned under multiple international conventions.
Which the U.S. does not recognize.
The U.S. refuses to recognize it. But these are, the first time I saw the aftermath of a cluster bomb was in Yugoslavia in the 90s, when Clinton was waging his 78-day bombing campaign against the wishes of the United Nations, against Yugoslavia. And they're basically like flying landmines. And they spread over a multi-football field area, and they literally shred flesh into ground meat. And they use these devastating weapons on this village. And so this journalist takes photographs of it, and he goes on Al Jazeera and provides them to international news organizations and gives them to Amnesty International. And Amnesty International has a munitions expert look at them. And they determined that it was Tomahawk cruise missiles manufactured by General Dynamics. They say on them, made in the United States. Yemen's Air Force and military does not have those weapons. And so it was clear that the US was now bombing Yemen. After he exposed the Majla bombing and the fact that it was a US operation, despite the pronouncements of the American and Yemeni governments, he was snatched off the streets one day by the US-backed counterterrorism unit in Yemen, and was taken to a political security prison and beaten bloody and told, if you don't stop talking about the strike on al-Majla, we're going to put you back in here for good. And he continued to talk about it. And he also continued to interview leaders of al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. And if you read his reporting, he did very critical interviews with them. He makes the White House press corps look like the sheeple that they are.
He interviewed al-Awlaki, didn't he?
He interviewed Anwar al-Awlaki, who was not a leader of al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. He interviewed Nasr al-Waheshi, Saeed al-Shiri, the leadership of al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. At one point, these guys are trying to sort of test his strength as a journalist, and they have him put on a suicide vest that they've made, and they're joking that they're going to click it. So this is this journalist who's doing this reporting, and he wrote that story up about how they had him put. So I'm just saying he was a fascinating, really independent-minded journalist who was exposing this U.S. the widening U.S. war and interviewing the people that the U.S. had determined to be the leaders of the organization that Washington claimed represented the greatest external threat to the American to America.
And also, to flip it from another perspective, couldn't find.
Right. And so this journalist can go and find all these people that are the most high-value targets in Yemen, and the CIA has no idea where they are.
Yeah.
In fact, when I was in Yemen, this tribal leader said to me, he's like, listen, I just saw Saeed al-Shiri in this restaurant in Shebwa the other night. How is it that your drones can seem to find all of our children, but they can't find Saeed al-Shiri?
Yeah.
I mean, but he actually wasn't sort of joking. He was literally asking me, how come you can find our kids and you can't find the leaders of al-Qaeda? Which is a fair question. So Abdullah al-Haider Shaya continues to do this reporting. A few months later, his home is raided in a night raid. And he is abducted by the counterterrorism unit, taken back to that prison, and he has disappeared for 30 days. After a month, he is brought into a special court that was set up by the Yemeni dictator to prosecute journalists who had committed crimes against the state, journalistic crimes against the state. And he's brought into court in a cage, literally in a cage. And they charge him with being an al-Qaeda facilitator. And some of the charges against him actually carried the death penalty. And he refused to present a defense and said he wasn't going to recognize the legitimacy of the court. Every major mainstream human rights organization in the world and media freedom organization in the world condemned his trial as a sham trial.
So, of course, the President of the United States came to Shaya's defense, right?
Yes, our constitutional law professor president took a noble stance on this. So this journalist gets sentenced to 5 years in prison. And there was tremendous outcry, tremendous pressure, tribally and through journalists and human rights organizations. And the dictator of Yemen decides he's going to pardon him. And the guy's been in prison for about a year at this point. News leaks in the Yemeni media that this is going to happen, that the dictator is going to pardon Abdullah al-Haider Shaya. And that day, Ali Abdullah Saleh gets a phone call from the White House, not from some undersecretary of blah, 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 from the president himself. President Obama says to the dictator of Yemen that the United States is deeply concerned about reports that you plan to release Abdullah al-Haider Shaya. And the pardon was ripped up, and he remains in prison to this day. He remains in prison because of our Nobel Peace Prize winning constitutional law professor president.
Who wants so desperately, as he told you at the National Defense University, to wind down this war?
Well, look, you've got these super soaker parties that Chuck Todd and the boys go to on Joe Biden's lawn. You've got all these liberal bloggers meeting with the White House so they can get on message with them. You have the Justice Department scooping up the phone records of some of the best reporters in the country from the Associated Press, Adam Goldman, Matt Apuzzo, Kim Dozier, doing very critical reporting on the CIA. No coincidence that they're seizing the phone records of all of their telephones and going after these guys. And there is a war on journalism to an extent in this country, combined with a war on whistleblowers. This president has used the Espionage Act more than all of his predecessors in the last 100 years combined. And so if you take those two facts, it's bad enough as it is. But then the case that we also should be talking about as journalists, we should be standing up and saying something, is that our president is keeping a Yemeni journalist in prison because he was a journalist. And that should be chilling to all of us. But Where are the news organizations? He worked for Washington Post, NBC News, ABC News. Where are those news outlets standing up for him? None of them have said anything. When I confronted people from one of those outlets about it and said, why don't you guys do anything? They said, oh, well, the White House told us that the money we were paying him was being used to fund Al-Qaeda. Now, I know how little money journalists in those countries get paid by foreign news organizations. And if that's Al-Qaeda's main source of funding, then they're in big trouble for their future prospectus.
But really, there's a precedent for this. Al Jazeera had reporters imprisoned at Guantanamo Bay.
Sami Al-Haj.
And there seems to be this really malignant, long-standing meme whereby all, whether it's the Bush administration or the Obama administration, has to do is call a Muslim reporter a terrorist, and you get news organizations that have previously backed them just really having their hands off and just being afraid to challenge that basic designation.
Oh, I mean, what was amazing too is how all of a sudden, out of nowhere during the, you know, what was called the Arab Spring, Al Jazeera became this great media outlet.
That's
and
right.
Hillary Clinton's singing its praises. I mean, let's remember what happened to Al Jazeera. Thrown off the floor of NASDAQ and the New York Stock Exchange after 9/11.
Physically bombed.
Their office was bombed in Kabul, Afghanistan. Then the United States bombs the Sheraton Hotel in Basra at the early stages of the U.S. invasion of Iraq, where Al Jazeera were the only guests. Then they bomb on April 8th. They bomb the offices of Al Jazeera in Baghdad and kill one of the most famous foreign correspondents for Al Jazeera, Tariq Ayub. And also killed a number of other journalists at that time, Jose Cuso, a Spanish cameraman, and then a Ukrainian cameraman for Reuters. But the war against Al Jazeera, nothing gives lie more to the pronouncements that the U.S. is trying to build democracy in that region than the attacks on Al Jazeera. The one outlet, the only media outlet to be thrown out of Saddam and Washington's Iraq. And Al Jazeera's current trajectory is going to be interesting to watch because it's, you know, with the launch of Al Jazeera Americas, but they did some of the absolute best reporting on the Iraq War and on the post 9/11 realities, and they were targeted for it, and their journalists were killed. And in the case that you mentioned before, Sami Al-Haj, who was a cameraman, spent 6+ years in Guantanamo, was interrogated hundreds of times, and they were trying to get him to say that Al Jazeera had a connection to terrorism. Their connection to terrorism was that they were reporting on it in a far more critical way than any U.S. media outlets at the time.
I want to pause here for a second. If you have note cards and want to ask Jeremy a question, please do write it down. We'll collect those and go through them. Before we do, I want to tilt this onto a different axis for a second. There's a as much as there are caricatures of the people who become the victims and the consequences of these dirty wars, there are some about the men and women who prosecute. And I want to talk to you about the disconnect between some of those and reality. You hear a lot about drones as remote control warfare, as video game warfare. And I wanted to get your thoughts on this. I know you've talked to some of the people who actually pilot these machines, and I have as well. And I've been struck at the opposite impression coming across about actually when you're the, in the case of the Air Force, the young officer, or in the case of the Army, a warrant officer, someone who's an enlisted person and not a particularly senior one, with the responsibility of actually pressing the trigger that releases the missile that kills people, I've been struck by the gravity that they take to it and the consequences that they find that they bear emotionally. We're actually now seeing cases where drone pilots are talking finally about PTSD that they experience, which is something that isn't really a concept that a lot of people come about. So what's your experience been when you talk to the practitioners of the wars that you're writing about, as dirty as those wars are?
Yeah, you know, I mean, for years, I would always tell people that we have to humanize the people that live on the other side of the barrel of the gun of U.S. foreign policy and know them as people the way that we get to know the victims of school shootings in this country, and realized over the course of years of reporting on this that I wasn't even humanizing the people who were fighting these wars or being deployed by the president to do these operations. And it was when I started to get to know people within JSOC who worked on some of these task forces or were working in the CIA that I started to have a much deeper understanding of the program itself. And so I have gotten to know people who are SEALs, Delta Force guys, some Army Rangers, and people that work on the targeting program, the actual operations in the Horn of Africa and elsewhere. And I've noticed a shift over the past few years. A lot of those guys are saying that they look back and don't understand fully what the point of it was. And I think we're going to, it'll be interesting to see if we have special ops guys that start speaking out. I mean, I don't think there's going to be a Navy SEALs against the war anytime soon. But I do think that there's a lot of consternation in that community about what they're being asked to do and where they're being asked to do it, and a sense that some of this stuff doesn't seem to be legal. And some of it actually seems to be encouraging blowback. This is skipping ahead in our story a bit, but I think it's an interesting story. I recently met a Navy SEAL who worked very closely with General Stanley McChrystal in Iraq when McChrystal was the JSOC commander and running this sort of Murder, Inc. operation. And Spencer's written some great articles about the extent to which JSOC was killing on an industrial scale in Iraq and the myth that David Petraeus and the Surge, it was some sort of epic story. There was tremendous killing and murder happening, combined with paying Sunni tribes not to kill American soldiers. That was sort of what went on for that couple-year period. That's where the claim is that Petraeus won the war. But I met this guy, and his last tour was in Yemen. And he was part of the operations that killed both Anwar al-Awlaki and Anwar al-Awlaki's 16-year-old son 2 weeks later. And Anwar al-Awlaki's 16-year-old son, who was a U.S. citizen from Denver, Colorado, had nothing whatsoever to do with terrorism. He was being raised by his grandparents. He hadn't seen his father in years when he was killed. And he's sitting in an outdoor restaurant having dinner with his teenage cousins when a drone appears above them and they blow him up. And the United States has never provided an explanation for why that kid was killed.
We've now actually got an emendation to that comment, which is amazing, just an absolutely remarkable thing, which was the White House and the Justice Department last week releasing some very vague information about the targeted killing program and how it's impacted Americans. And for the first time, the Obama administration acknowledged that 4 Americans were killed by drone strikes. I shouldn't have said targeted killing before to contradict my earlier point, but again, I struggle with the terminology. 3 of those people, they say, this was one of the most astonishing euphemisms I've come across in a decade of doing this reporting, where they said, and this is a quote, not intentionally targeted.
Yeah, not specifically targeted.
It's an amazing way of saying we didn't mean to kill these people, or we didn't know that we were killing these people, and yet we've killed them, and we stop short of allowing for any redress of the fact that American citizens, without any sense of due process, were killed by their government.
Right, and on
suspicion.
To me, the phrase "not specifically targeted" it seems like such a carefully crafted wording.
Lawyered to death, right?
Yeah, lawyered to death. I'm sure that there were whiteboards galore, PowerPoint presentations, focus groups within the CIA of what phrase to use here. I mean, I think it's possible that al-Awlaki's kid was killed intentionally. I think that's a possibility. John Brennan suspected that. That was an intentional hit, and ordered a review on it. And that review, I tried to get the review, and the White House wouldn't even confirm that it had happened. But I was told by a former very senior official of the Obama administration who worked on that operation that Brennan was convinced that it was an intentional hit, perhaps based on false intelligence that he was 21 and not 16, or that he was actually with an al-Qaeda cell or something. What seems also possible is that he was killed in a pre-crime operation, that he was with other military-aged males. Mm-hmm. And in the targeted regions of Yemen, 16 means you're a military-aged male. He can't join the military in the United States,
right?
And he is a U.S. citizen, but he's considered a military-aged male. So why did they kill this kid? Not specifically targeted is the current answer. When Robert Gibbs was asked about it, the former White House press secretary, he said he should have had a more responsible father. Harry Reid, the Senate Majority Leader, was asked about it on CNN by Candy Crowley and said, if there were 3 Americans who deserved to be killed, referring to al-Awlaki, Samir Khan, and the kid, those 3 deserved to be killed. I tried to get Harry Reid's office to clarify what he meant about that, and they would not comment on it. But here's Harry Reid, who has access to serious intelligence, saying that
that kid... One of the so-called Gang of Eight.
One of the Gang of Eight. The people that are allowed to go into the padded room and look at some of the memos of the White House but never write anything down and then never tell anyone what they've seen when they go in, that's the oversight of the kill program, said that he deserved to be killed. So to me, why Abdulrahman al-Awlaki was killed says a lot about who we are as a nation. And the fact that it took more than 600 days after the assassination of Anwar al-Awlaki for the United States to actually admit that it had done the operation, because it had only just been in leaks that the U.S. was responsible, just shows you how asleep at the wheel Congress is. You know, when Rand Paul sounds like the most sane member of Congress for part of a day on this issue, which he did. And I give him a lot of credit for what he did that day. And, you know, I take with a huge grain of salt what a lot of the other people from the Tea Party did. I think that, you know, Obama likes drones, they hate drones. Sarah Palin's tweeting about, you know, how bad drones are. Give me a break. She is shooting animals from a helicopter. I mean, she's, of course she's going to use drones. But how we treat, like, how we treat the most reprehensible of our citizens, someone like Anwar al-Awlaki, who said things and was involved with things that I find utterly reprehensible. How we treat him says a lot about who we are.
This is a great way to sort of wrap up our blathering, and then we'll bring you guys in. You made a really, I think, courageous decision in this book to tell the story of Anwar al-Awlaki, threaded throughout this 520-page narrative, from where he is at and before 9/11 to where he is in 2011 when he's killed. Can you talk about why you decided to do that and what you ended up finding out when you really delved into who this man, who the Obama administration was obsessed and ultimately successful at killing, was?
Yeah, I mean, I am eternally fascinated by the story of who, the enigma of Anwar al-Awlaki. I mean, you know, this is a guy who was born in Las Cruces, New Mexico, and for the first part of his life was raised, you know, as an American, and was going to Disneyland and attending schools in the United States. And his father, who I know very well, Dr. Nasser al-Awlaki, had been a Fulbright scholar in the U.S. and then was a government minister in Yemen, and has spent much of his life working on addressing the water crisis in Yemen, severe water crisis in Yemen. And I also was, just by way of disclosure, allowed to talk to all of the members of the al-Awlaki family, which is very unusual. Most journalists, I think I'm the only journalist that's been allowed to spend time with Anwar al-Awlaki's mother, with all of his siblings. One of his brothers is a beekeeper who looks exactly like him. And when I walked into the al-Awlaki compound and I saw him, I was like, Anwar al-Awlaki's not dead. And then he,
but
you know,
now you're about to be.
Right, well, you know what, the other members of that family, you know, there's the youngest brother of Anwar al-Awlaki, Amar, is a totally like westernized, almost like semi-hipster, who works for an oil company and kind of has like this slick back hair. And he said, none of my friends will get in my car with me anymore because they're afraid that that they're going to be killed. And you know, I mean, imagine that family. The eldest son is killed, and then 2 weeks later, the eldest grandson is killed. Yeah. And the grandson has no connection to any of this whatsoever, except that that was his last name. But I had access to this family. I spent extensive time with them. I was there during Ramadan, and I kept the fast with them. So I would go to their house every day, and every day they would end up saying, oh, you have to eat with us. So I really got a clear sense of who this family was. And, you know, Anwar al-Awlaki was a guy who was not particularly religious. He came back to the United States just as the Gulf War was starting in 1990, 91, and went to college in Colorado. He wasn't particularly religious. He didn't have any politics. He watches I remember being 16 when the bombing of Baghdad started, watches the destruction of Iraq and starts to get involved with political activism on his campus. And he was studying engineering at the time. He then starts working with anti-war groups on the campus and is invited to give a speech at a local mosque. And the imam at the mosque says, oh, you have a real gift for speaking. You know, you should come back more. And al-Awlaki, his life takes a different path, and he starts studying Islamic scholarship and ends up becoming an imam himself. And he's in Denver, and then he's in San Diego. And on 9/11, he was the head of the Dar al-Hijra religious center in Falls Church, Virginia, a very large mosque. And he was all over the media. And I actually remember seeing him on TV. He was on PBS, he was on Talk of the Nation, he was profiled by the Washington Post in a story about Ramadan. And what he was saying was Al-Qaeda has perverted the religion of Islam, and that the killing of innocent Muslims by the United States during the Iraq War or the sanctions period of Bill Clinton does not justify the killing of one US civilian in New York or Washington, D.C. And at the same time, he is dealing with the FBI behind the scenes, interrogating him repeatedly. They're targeting Muslim businesses. They're rounding Muslims up. There's this witch hunt going on. And al-Awlaki had multiple run-ins with the FBI. And I tell this story in the book. I think that it's possible that the FBI actually viewed al-Awlaki as a flippable asset. that they could have turned him into an informant. A, because of his politics, but B, because he had been arrested twice on charges of soliciting a prostitute in San Diego, and they had these charges sort of hovering over him. And I think that part of the reason why he decided to leave the United States is because the FBI was putting tremendous pressure on him to become an FBI informant.
And lots of your Muslim neighbors around the country have similar stories of this. Mm.
And one of the craziest things in this insane story is that Awlaki, shortly after 9/11, is invited to give a lecture at a luncheon at the Pentagon and accepts the invitation and goes to the Pentagon and gives a speech about the state of Islam in the world today. And to give you a sense of how bad the intelligence was at the time in the Pentagon as they're gearing up for their Iraq war, they served a bacon sandwich at Anwar Awlaki's. We got the menu. It's been declassified. That wasn't a joke.
It was classified.
Yeah. The menu was classified, but now we know that you could have a bacon roll-up and hear Imam Anwar Awlaki speak about Islam.
So how
in the world
did he go from the Pentagon to Yemen and onto, you know, the number one outside of Osama bin Laden targeting list?
Yeah, I mean, I tell this in a very detailed way, but I'll give you the sort of shorter version of it. So Awlaki decides, for whatever reason, to leave the United States for good. He goes back to Yemen and is sort of flailing around. He's attending classes. He's recording sermons. His sermons start popping up, his CDs, in terror investigations in the U.S., Canada, Britain. And the United States, of course, knew who Anwar Awlaki was, but then they start looking at him being an inspiration for what they called lone wolf terrorists, or cells that were sort of freestanding and going to organize plots to bomb public transportation. And they start putting pressure, the U.S. starts putting pressure on the Yemeni government to shut him up. And in 2006, Awlaki is arrested in Yemen on trumped-up charges of intervening in a tribal dispute. And he is put in prison for 18 months. And the United Nations investigated his imprisonment and said that it was extra legal. And Awlaki believed that he was being held at the request of the U.S. government. I report in the book, based on sources that I have in both the U.S. and Yemen, that it was John Negroponte, who's the director of national intelligence, who met with a senior Yemeni official and Bandar Bush, the famed Saudi diplomat, whose nickname is Bandar Bush because he's so close to the Bushes. And Negroponte said to the Yemenis, we want Awlaki kept in prison for 4 to 5 years so that people forget about him. So that, I think that's why he ultimately was put in prison. They just wanted to silence him. So he spent 17 of the 18 months in solitary confinement. And they limited the amount of books that he could have. I mean, he had the Quran. He also had books by Saib Qutb, who is the intellectual godfather of the ideology of Al-Qaeda, and Ibn Taymiyyah and other influential Islamist thinkers. And he also was given Shakespeare, and he said he couldn't stand Shakespeare. Shakespeare was an imperialist, but he loved Charles Dickens, and would compare figures in the U.S. and Yemeni governments to characters from Dickens, like Uriah Heep and other. So he comes out of prison a changed man, and was really transformed by that experience, and starts a blog, Imam Anwar's blog, and the internet becomes his mosque. And on the one hand, he's doing like food reviews on it and answering questions from people about, is a particular kind of cheese, if purchased from a non-halal grocery store, acceptable for Muslims to eat? And then the next day, he'd be talking about, is suicide bombing permissible under the teachings of the Quran? And it was really when Nidal Hassan shot up his fellow soldiers in Fort Hood, Texas. Major Nidal Hassan killed 13 of his fellow soldiers and wounded scores of others. It came out that Awlaki had been in email contact with him. Though U.S. intelligence determined that Awlaki didn't appear to have any role in the shooting, that story persists to this day, that Awlaki was behind the Fort Hood shooting.
These emails have been declassified, by the way.
And the emails, and you can read them. And I mean, it was sort of a bizarre, he was almost like a stalker, a weird stalker of Awlaki.
Really creepy.
Yeah. He's like, at one point he says to Awlaki, I want to give you a $5,000 prize. And Awlaki says, give it to orphans. And he says, I want to have an essay contest in your name. And then my favorite is he says,
that's cool.
Hey, bro, can you find me a wife in Yemen? And Awlaki's like, yeah, I'll keep an eye out for a brother. I mean, it's like, you know, sort of.
But Awlaki, from the emails, does not respond to Nidal Hassan's almost constant pressure to get him to bless attacks on Americans.
Right. And Hassan is, you know, it's interesting because Nidal Hassan was an army psychiatrist who was listening to the stories of all of these guys that were coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan and actually tried to get some of his patients prosecuted for war crimes based on what they had told him during the course of his treatment of them. And his, you know, someone someday is going to write a very fascinating book about that massacre and what was behind it. But what sort of sealed al-Awlaki's fate was the day after that massacre, Anwar al-Awlaki wrote a blog, the title of which was Nidal Hassan Was a Hero. And he called on other Muslims in the US military to become Nidal Hassans. And the CIA then shuts down his blog, and al-Awlaki ends up...
The servers were in the United States, I think, right?
Yeah, and it was something like Wild Bill Domains out of Arizona, which is... anyway, so many bizarre parts of the story. But al-Awlaki goes underground, and he and the U.S. starts effectively hunting him. The Majla bombing happens December 17th, 2009. December 24th, 2009, the U.S. tries to kill Anwar al-Awlaki for the first time. December 25th, the underwear bomb plot happens. January of 2010, the Washington Post reveals that Anwar al-Awlaki, an American citizen, is on the kill list. And by my count, there were about a dozen attempts to kill al-Awlaki, including some that were straight out of like a Hollywood movie, where vehicles were switched in a dust storm, and al-Awlaki drives off one way, and his car goes off the other.
This is told in a riveting way in the book, by the way.
And then eventually, the CIA, this is an insane story, the CIA found a wife, a new wife for Anwar al-Awlaki.
It was the CIA's dating service.
This former, Spencer's a tattooed man, this former biker gangster guy named Murad Storm, cannot make this stuff up. And Murad Storm had met al-Awlaki in the early 2000s in Yemen. They were studying at the same university, and he was sort of an aspiring jihadist. And when the U.S. started hunting al-Awlaki, he realized he might be able to cash in on this. So he approaches. He's Danish. He approaches the Danish intelligence service, the PET, and says, "I think I can help find Anwar al-Awlaki," and ends up getting paid at least $250,000 for his work on this. And he starts communicating with al-Awlaki in encrypted emails, and saying that he wants to support him and help him. And all the while, he's working for the CIA and Danish intelligence, and they hatch this plot to suggest to al-Awlaki that he should take a bride to be underground with him. And so they literally posted on Facebook, "Who wants to marry Anwar al-Awlaki?" It was a sort of, the Bachelor Yemen version. And women start writing in and sending videos of themselves to Murad Storm.
And al-Awlaki responds by also sort of specifying what he's looking for
yes.
in a wife.
You have to be willing to live in a tent.
You got to move around
a lot. Move around a lot. Have limited toiletries available to
always
you.
Always have, this is specific, always have $3,000 on you.
Yes. Spencer actually read the book. No. So what ends up happening is al-Awlaki exchanges a series of video messages with this woman in Croatia who was a Catholic who had converted to Islam named Amina. And they're sort of web dating for a while, and then they decide that they'll get married. Now, al-Awlaki and Amina have no idea that this is a CIA plot. The CIA's idea is that they're going to send Amina to Yemen to go and meet with Anwar al-Awlaki and then kill both of them in a drone strike.
So we're recruiting a wife for Anwar al-Awlaki without her knowing it, so she can be the decoy that kills the both of them.
Exactly. And so Murad Storm presents her with a gift of brand new luggage when she's going to go to Yemen, and it's laced with these tracking devices that the CIA has put into the it's like the CIA's Louis Vuitton or whatever, Gucci bags, and she then travels to Yemen. Al-Awlaki's guys go to pick her up at the airport, and they are smart, and they tell her, "You have to ditch all your luggage, ditch all your clothes." They give her a new set of clothes. She goes off. The CIA's luggage is left behind. She marries Anwar al-Awlaki and then has a kid with him. And she currently, my understanding, is working for Inspire magazine, the magazine of Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. So the CIA's dating service resulted in al-Awlaki having this family underground on the run. That happened, and then they also tried to bribe al-Awlaki's youngest brother, Amar. They offered him $5 million to give up the location of Anwar al-Awlaki. They approached him in a hotel in Vienna, Austria. He didn't know where he was. But eventually, my understanding is that when JSOC captured this Somali guy, Warsame, in a boat between Yemen and Somalia, and then held him on a brig for 2 months incommunicado, large parts of it incommunicado.
He's imprisoned here in Manhattan, by the way.
He is. He's being prosecuted in civilian courts. Don't tell Lindsey Graham, but that he wasn't sent to Guantanamo. But anyway, he had given them enough information where they could sort of triangulate in general where al-Awlaki was. And then in September, they found him, and he was with Samir Khan, this Pakistani-American, whose family had been told by the FBI that there were no charges against him. My understanding is that there may have even been a grand jury that looked into charging Samir Khan and failed to return an indictment against him. So these two Americans, neither of whom had ever been charged with a crime by the United States for any allegations of terrorism, are then killed in this drone strike. And in Washington, the reactions were in two basic camps. Enthusiastic praise for the operation, where Hillary Clinton and John McCain sounded like the same person, or silence. And the only people that said anything about it in Washington were the usual suspects, Ron Paul and Dennis Kucinich, who both spoke out against it. This was 2 years before Rand Paul's filibuster. Where was the Tea Party at the time when this was actually happening? I mean, it just shows that this is not necessarily a sincere opposition on the part of a lot of the people now pretending to speak in defense of Americans who might be targeted in these assassination operations. So that happened in September of 2011, and then October 14th, they kill Awlaki's son and a group of other teenagers, and that brings us to the present, where you still have active drone strikes happening in Yemen, including against people whose identities we don't know.
So now we can get to the hard questions, which are yours. Cora Weiss wants to know, can we ever get out of dirty wars? How and can there be peace? So solve this problem, Jeremy.
Yeah. Well, as someone who criticizes the bankruptcy of the hope and change slogan, I don't want to run the risk of trying to give any hope that there could be change. I do think that it would require an entirely different political system in the United States. And I think that, well, what I mean by that is that we have large, powerful corporations that are the major funders of almost every single congressional campaign. And there is almost no incentive for members of Congress to turn their backs on big energy, big war money, the weapons industry, big oil. And as long as we have corporations running our political process in this country, I don't think that you're going to have enough members of Congress with a stiff enough spine to be willing to stand up to it. I mean, the fact is that you have a limited number of members of Congress that are even allowed to look at a fraction of the documents pertaining to the assassination program or the crowd kill program or whatever we're deciding to call it now. And they don't even ask the right questions. I've been told by people who've sat in on classified briefings with JSOC and the CIA that a lot of members of the Senate don't ask questions to which they don't want the answer. And so if that's the reality, you would need like 100 Russ Feingolds to be in on these hearings, to be asking actual questions in order for it to fundamentally change. The Obama legacy with this is, I like to envision Cheney fly fishing somewhere and sort of nodding his head and saying, Obama's kind of a gangster, he's cleaned it up for us to continue this stuff, because McCain wouldn't have been able to do it in the way that Obama has done it. And you wouldn't see polls with 70% of liberals, self-identified liberals, supporting drone strikes.
There was an amazing quote from Lindsey Graham again a couple days ago.
You really like him.
I just find myself like I can't get away from him.
Right.
Like everywhere I go, there's Lindsey Graham. Every time I try and write, he's just always there. In which, after Obama's speech, which Graham blessed him for, someone asks him, how does any of this end? And Graham just says, with this amazing aplomb and candor, well, eventually there'll be a Republican president who'll declare it all over.
Oh yeah. Oh right. No. Well, I don't know. I mean, but look at
but
how
there's
we.
Some, but there
look
is
how we
something
to
that. Yeah.
Well, yes, and no. I mean, look at how we respond to all of the major issues facing the country. We call it a war on crime, where we see a paramilitarization of law enforcement in this country. War on drugs, totally militarized and paramilitarized. In Mexico and elsewhere. When we have events like the Boston Marathon bombing, you see calls for Jahar Tsarnaev to be treated as an enemy combatant, not be given his Miranda rights, and some calls for him to be sent to Guantanamo. There's this sort of collective fear that I think grips the country, and it's so illogical relative to the threat actually posed by terrorism versus other threats in our society.
And this is from the live stream, and it's a great question because it also references some other earlier very good work that you've done. Your previous work was an exploration of Blackwater's origins. What do you think of Blackwater founders Eric Prince's actions in Somalia with something called the Puntland Maritime Police Force?
Right.
Another amazing story.
Yeah. So, Eric Prince, the mercenary kingpin who founded Blackwater, did the ultra-patriotic thing that you do. He moved to the United Arab Emirates and set up shop there. And he's involved with all sorts of murky businesses these days. And for years, he had been looking at trying to have a for-profit counter-piracy force that would work around the Horn of Africa and in the Arabian Peninsula. He actually had purchased this huge vessel called the MacArthur and had this vision of it being this sort of paramilitary floating craft that could be used to take down the evil Somali pirates.
It was actually called the MacArthur.
The MacArthur, right. And what could go wrong with white mercenaries in Africa?
Nothing. I mean, it's a good thing that history isn't real.
Right. So, you know, you know what's insane is that Eric Prince was just in New York recently at the Tribeca Film Festival.
To see Dirty Wars.
No. Look, Mr. Prince is always welcome to come to a screening. I'll do a talk back with him if he wants. If he wants to blurb the book, I'd be happy to have his name on it. I was told by someone once that Blackwater had my face on targets at the Moyoc shooting range, that they would shoot me on their things, which was... And someone who leaked... I was leaked thousands of documents from within the company, and I did these stories about how they were working for Monsanto and Disney and Chevron. But one of the documents was an intelligence report on me that Blackwater had done. They had come to a talk I gave at Busboys and Poets in Washington, D.C., and actually wrote up the talk. And it was one of the most devastating moments of my life because they said that Scahill's story is generally accurate. I mean, I wasn't disappointed that it was accurate, but that they seemed to not have a problem with what I was saying. I was like, I'm doing something wrong. But Eric Prince was here because there's a movie called The Project that's been made about this Puntland Maritime Authority, and Eric Prince is a character in the film, and it's made by Adam Saralsky, the former CIA lawyer who sued the agency for saying it was anti-Semitic.
And if I'm not mistaken, worked for 60 Minutes for a
little
while.
Yes, he worked for 60 Minutes. And then he wrote this puff piece for Vanity Fair about Eric Prince, in which he was facilitating Eric Prince doing something called graymailing. At a time when maybe there was the government was considering indicting Eric Prince, Prince comes out with this big profile in Vanity Fair about him, and he basically... goes Don Corleone on the U.S. government and says, if you come after me, I know where the bodies are buried, and I'm going to start talking about all these ops that you had us doing that you don't want out in the public domain. And I think that's part of why they backed off of Eric Prince, because he effectively graymailed them from pursuing him. So he was recently back on the red carpet at the Tribeca Film Festival. He's also recently gotten in bed with some Chinese investors in a project to target Africa, and very much wrapped up in the mercenary game still in Somalia and elsewhere.
Eric Prince, man.
Got any conspiracy theories you can ask me about?
No. You know, you guys are good about this. You know, a lot of the events we do really are filled with conspiracy stuff. So, good job, you guys.
Speak for yourself, man. I have sane people that come to
you
my
have
event.
Sane people. This is a good question. How and why and what reasoning does Obama say privately versus what he says publicly for continuing Bush policies? This is something that I have not been able to answer myself, but there is a kind of internal cognitive dissonance you sometimes see spill out, not to put the president on the couch, but do you have any thoughts on that?
I mean, I'm the last journalist that would ever be invited to one of these private little meetups at the White House, so I couldn't tell you what the president says privately to people. I did back in the day when this is my one real Obama story. In 2004, I smoked a cigarette next to Barack Obama at the Democratic National Convention in Boston when he spoke. I go out this door and I see Barack Obama there, and at the time I was a smoker, I'm not anymore, and I light up a cigarette, and he's standing there, and I don't even remember what our conversation was. We made small talk for a moment, then he walked in, and then that night he's at the Democratic National Convention giving a big speech. I differentiate between Obama and Dick Cheney in terms of how they see the world. I don't view Obama as this sort of cartoonish villain in his lair plotting the destruction of the world for the increase in Halliburton stock. And I think that there are large parts of that that are true about Cheney, that are actually legitimately true. I think that this is a guy who had no military experience, very limited foreign policy experience, and comes into office having had to campaign on a pledge to be tougher on terrorism than John McCain. Who was campaigning on the idea that he's a war hero, which is ironic for anyone that knows anything about the Vietnam War. But he comes into office then And he starts to receive these briefings. In fact, he received his first full access briefing after he got the Democratic nomination, when Michael Hayden, who was then the CIA director, goes to Chicago and briefs him at a federal building and basically paints this picture of a world where there are thousands of concurrent plots against the United States to bring down aircraft, blow up embassies, poison water supplies. Then he comes into office, and who is he surrounded by that's been running these operations? Admiral William McRaven, who worked for the National Security, original member of SEAL Team 6, who had hurt his back prior to 9/11, so couldn't forward deploy, ends up working at the National Security Council in the early days after 9/11 and helps develop the Bush administration's KILL program. Then he's running JSOC under Obama. Stanley McChrystal, who ran JSOC for the duration of the Bush era. And David Petraeus, this incredibly powerful figure, closely aligned with Dick Cheney. Those three guys go to President Obama and say, we need you to continue the expanded authorities that Bush and Cheney gave us to hit in countries at will. And in fact, we want expanded authorities. We want to be able to start striking in an intense way in Yemen and in Somalia, and to start to forward deploy troops in the north of Africa and in parts of Western Africa. And what's Obama going to do? It would have been a transformational moment if he had stood and told them to stand down. Hmm. And so I think he very early on got seduced with JSOC and the idea of what they call targeted killing, and this idea that they would be doing a surgical decapitation of the heads of these networks. And I think that Obama embraced that as a smarter war and a cleaner war, and one that he could argue was difficult but necessary.
The word surgical is one of the most destructive to ever use.
I'm talking about how they talk about
it. I know you're not saying that, but it is really something that you tend to find people using a lot, almost as a verbal tick, to try and say, well, we're not really like that kind of war. Right. I want to read out this one because someone in the audience is cutting against the grain of this whole talk, and I appreciate that. Is there ever a time when using a drone strike may be legal or justified, such as if all other methods of apprehension and extradition have been exhausted?
Yeah, I mean, there's a moral answer to this, and then there's the legal answer. I mean, I don't think that the United States has a right to be assassinating people around the world without charging them with crimes or presenting evidence that they are actually engaged in plots. But I'm not just trying to get the applause line. I'll answer the question. You know, the scenario that's sort of presented in this, and in fact, I think it was literally presented in one of the briefings recently that the White House gave, that you've got a sniper who is pointing a loaded weapon on a rooftop at a crowd full of civilians. What are you going to do to take that individual out? Are you going to run to a court and seek an indictment for them plotting to kill these people? No, you're not going to, because there's an imminent threat. So your options are you can try to capture that individual, which of course is preferable, or you kill that person before they shoot up this crowd. The one argument that people could make that was effective is if you had some imminent action that the individual that you're going to kill is going to carry out. Like you've got someone who's actually going to unleash some chemical substance into the subway in New York, and it's impossible to capture that individual. There's all sorts of ways legally that you could justify taking that person out. That is not even close to the majority of the cases. That, in fact, I've yet to see evidence that scenario has occurred on a more global scale as applies to a terror plot, that if we don't kill this person, this airplane is going to be brought down. The Justice Department, in its white paper that was leaked a few months ago, redefined the term imminent in a way that no reasonable person would agree with the definition.
What the Justice Department said was imminence is best understood outside of any specific information of an actual plot happening, which is the normal common sense understanding of what this word actually means, and defined it in terms of being a co-belligerent. Basically, you are affiliated in some nebulous way that whose tensile strength of that affiliation is never either defined or tested with Al-Qaeda or its allies, and that means you're an imminent threat.
Because I think there's a mob mentality about this stuff where, you know, it used to be back in the day you'd go and get the pitchforks and round up the posse and go met out citizens' justice. Now we say, oh, we'll kill them before they kill us. I mean, I've heard so many self-identified liberal Democrats say that. You know, I mean, I get called a terrorist sympathizer almost every single day of my life now. And I'm saying something that I think is basic common sense. Shouldn't we have actual evidence against people that we are setting out to go and kill around the world, that they actually are representing a threat? I mean, what happened to any vague notion of due process? or international order. I mean, the United States has asserted the right to bump people off wherever it deems there to be a threat against the phrase of the day now is a threat against U.S. persons. You know, they can figure out a way for there to always be threats against U.S. persons.
This is a good one and one I've thought about and have no good answer to, so I'm going to unfairly pose it to you. Are there any prospects for making a Truth and Reconciliation Committee happen?
No.
No. Yeah, okay. All right, moving on.
That's for that's for countries in Africa and Latin America,
right,
Spencer.
Exactly.
We're America.
I should have known better. Again, history isn't real, so that's a good thing. Is the U.S. deliberately triggering blowback so it has an excuse to ramp up wars?
No, I don't think so. I don't, but there's something to... I think that we're whistling past the graveyard of our own policy. We are inspiring new enemies. I think it's complicated. I wouldn't say that we're inspiring new terrorists because people with a legitimate score to settle have killed members of their family. I mean, can you call them terrorists? I mean, it's a cliche, but one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. If you kick down the doors of someone's house and you kill, as I tell this story about Gardez in Afghanistan, you kill pregnant women and then you dig the bullets out of their bodies to cover up the fact that you've killed them. And then the husband, you know, says to me, I want to put on a suicide vest and go and blow myself up among the Americans. And he didn't know, but he was sort of paraphrasing Malcolm X and saying, you know, when a snake, you know, bites your child, you don't go out looking for that specific snake. Any snake will do. I think there are a lot of attacks that happen against U.S. forces because people are retaliating from something other U.S. forces or mercenary forces did. We are going to pay a price for our policies around the world. And it's going to probably be American civilians that pay for it. It's not going to be the powerful.
You know, you heard in court Faisal Shahzad, the would-be Times Square bomber. This has actually been misreported widely. He didn't say that it was because of the drone program in Afghanistan. In court, he actually made a far more expansive argument that the reason why he decided he wanted to blow up Americans in Times Square, which at the time was where my former organization Wired was based, so it would. You know, it concentrated my mind quite a great deal, was because of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. Yeah. You know, there's this meme out there that the drone program is sort of something different, but this is all back to the dirty wars acknowledged and unacknowledged. One question that we really do have a hard time answering and configuring, but is asked very forthrightly by someone here or on the live stream, is just what's the future of these activities? What's the future of this program? Where do you see, particularly after Obama's speech, these wars transiting to or taking the shape of?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. And part of the reason that I called the book Dirty Wars is also a reference to what the U.S. was doing in Central America in the 1980s, you know, where you had the funding of the Contra death squads in Nicaragua and backing of Battalion 316 in Honduras, the targeting of Catholics in various countries who were liberation theology practitioners and had the audacity to support popular movements that had a preferential option for the poor. And you had the full spectrum of covert and overt warfare. You had proxy forces, you had the U.S. backing juntas, and you had the CIA and the military engaged in assassination operations and targeting the leadership of various organizations. And I think we're returning to some version of that now. Despite the fact that President Obama gave the indication that he didn't want the U.S. to be in a state of perpetual war, he also used that same phrase in his inauguration, his second inauguration. I know most of us were focused on Beyonce lip-syncing, but there was actually... The next day, then, there was a drone strike in Yemen after he said we don't want perpetual war. And I think what actually
As there was 6 days after this speech, supposedly, about ramping down the drone program.
Exactly, right, in Pakistan, yeah. And my understanding is that there may have also been a drone strike this week in Yemen. I mean, and friends of mine in Sana'a said that there have been drones flying closer to the actual city of Sana'a over the past couple of days, which is interesting. I mean, we'll see what comes of that. But I think that the exact opposite of what has been reported about the president's intent is actually the reality. I think that this administration is ensuring that it is going to continue on in perpetuity because they are mainstreaming the program, creating this thing called the disposition matrix, which is sort of an algorithm to determine who should be killed, who we might be able to capture. And they're institutionalizing it in a very formal way. There's another way of looking at President Obama's speech the other day, and that is that he came out and did a full frontal defense of the U.S. asserting the right to assassinate people around the world. I mean, you can cut through all of the rhetoric there, and that really is the takeaway. If you remove the some of the historical context and just look at sort of what the message is there, and not that for the first time ever he's saying this or that, just look at what the speech. He is asserting the right of the United States to conduct these kinds of operations in perpetuity.
There was an Augustinian quality to it where...
This thing with Brennan being a priest and them being...
I mean that, you know, there's the famous St. Augustine quote that, Lord, let me be chaste, just not today.
Right. Yeah.
You sort of see that with the drone. So,
but do people know this, that there's this sort of gross portrayal of John Brennan and
Obama...
It was
from a Washington Post profile.
...as being these, like, monk-like, you know, just war theory guys who sit around between confession ceremonies. Yeah, they're real Jesuitical about their analysis of their assassination program. And, I mean, it really is kind of... Some of the stenography that's come out of this era is just despicable.
And that is journalistic subtweeting.
Yeah.
I'm going to be super... How are we on time? Do we have a... Okay, two more questions. So, a very good one. How is it possible to continue to use drones in Pakistan without the consent of their government? Well, about that.
You and I had a really interesting conversation earlier where you, it's going to probably require you grabbing your notebook, where you described the sort of year of the drone in Pakistan in 2010.
Yeah.
This is fascinating to me.
So this is a way of contextualizing the drone strikes in a way that I tend to find we write about this stuff without giving a reader an adequate understanding of the human consequences. So I didn't know this. I grew up in New York. The New York metropolitan area, so the five boroughs as well as the parts of New Jersey and Connecticut and upstate and Long Island that we think of as, you know, around New York, 11,842 square miles. The tribal areas in Pakistan, where the vast majority of the drone strikes have occurred, particularly under Obama from 2009 to the present, is a little smaller. It's about 10,000 square miles. New York City itself, its landmass is about 301 square miles, and Waziristan, North and South Waziristan, two of the most battered aspects of the tribal areas in Pakistan, that's about 5,000 square miles. So basically we're talking about, you know, for those of you who are from the area, you know, picture something a little bit smaller than, you know, where the local news broadcasts, where, you know, your sports teams can, you know, have the outside circles of their fandom. And in one year in Pakistan, in 2010, which is the height of the drone war, there were 122 drone strikes. There are 365 days in a year. So we're talking about, and imagine this, in an area about the size of the New York metropolitan area, an aerial assault from a missile once every 3 days. Right. And when you think about it like that, it really brings the human costs of this home in both a horrific and in a kind of clinical way.
Mm. Right, and the question about how can the drone strikes occur without the permission of the Pakistani government, one of the things that U.S. officials will say to you when you ask them about this is, we do have authority from the Yemeni government and the Pakistani government to do this. And, you know, Pakistan's government plays both sides of this and has for a long time, and there are conflicting interests within Pakistan where you have this need to condemn the drone strikes and stand up for Pakistan's sovereignty, and then on the other hand, you have very senior people within the Pakistani government colluding with the CIA or the U.S. military to conduct these operations. With the election of Nawaz Sharif, you know, he's indicated that he wants to stand up to the United States on this issue. I mean, he hasn't come out and sort of militantly staked out a position, but he's indicated that he doesn't like this. And I think that the U.S. is really going to test that.
It'll be interesting to see in the same way we often talk about, you know, Obama's transformation, if it ever really, you know, was genuine, from the character on the campaign trail to the personage as president, reflected with Sharif and with some opposition politicians like Imran Khan. It seems significant that this drone strike most recently in Pakistan that occurred on Wednesday took place during a period in time between governments in Pakistan, so there is no one to actually tell the United States no.
You know, one other thing, one of the most devastating things I think that the U.S. has done, I mean, in a sea of devastating things in Pakistan over the years, was when the CIA used this doctor to run this fake polio vaccination program in Pakistan. You know, Pakistan's one of the few countries in the world that actually is still dealing with a polio crisis, and it's serious. And a lot of organizations that were working on that issue have had to cease their work because the CIA contaminated that program by using this this doctor, and that doctor is in prison in Pakistan right now. But you know, using the cover of journalists or aid workers or medical workers puts those civilians at risk when the CIA or other organizations do that. And I think it's seldom talked about, but that's a really devastating aspect
and
of the Bin Laden story.
And the Pakistani Taliban openly talks about assassinating vaccine workers and other public health officials. It's caused a public health crisis directly in Pakistan as a little-known consequence mm-hmm. of what is mostly celebrated as the successful killing of Osama bin Laden. So let's end on this happy note. To what extent, if any, does U.S. and international law constrain the administration's counterterrorism activities?
Well, first of all, the U.S. doesn't recognize international law unless it's convenient. I mean, it's true. That's not a rhetorical statement. You know, when there was discussion in the 90s of ratifying the International Criminal Court, there were lawmakers that proposed legislation that they referred to as the Hague Invasion Act. That if U.S. personnel were actually brought up on war crimes charges, that the U.S. could send military forces in to liberate them from the international, you know, war crimes tribunals. And so, you know, there's one set of laws for the rest of the world, and then there's another set of laws for the United States. I do think that there have been attempts to challenge many of these wars by the Center for Constitutional Rights, challenging under the War Powers Act. And the idea that Congress did not give these authorities to the president to wage these wars. And the way that they'll get around it is they'll say, well, the authorization for the use of military force that was passed after 9/11 gives us the right to strike in any country where we determine there to be a connection to 9/11 or to the or to Al-Qaeda. In some cases now, we're targeting people who were toddlers on 9/11. How can we say that they were attached to it? And so when Obama said in his speech that he wants to refine the authorization for the use of military force and ultimately repeal it, I think that the first step of that is what's really disturbing, that they're talking about making more permanent the sort of perpetual war mentality, probably by removing language necessitating a connection to 9/11 or to Al-Qaeda from it, and so that they can broaden their justification. Also, this White House, like the Bush-Cheney people, rely very heavily on Article 2 of the Constitution, and an interpretation that the Commander-in-Chief Clause actually gives the president the right to unilaterally set these policies. It's effectively, they effectively perceive themselves as, on counterterrorism and national security issues, to be a dictatorship, and that Congress plays a very minimal role in those operations, only funding it and overseeing how the money is spent, but not necessarily overseeing the operations themselves. Now that, there are constitutional law experts that will say that that's a ridiculous interpretation of Article 2 of the Constitution, but it is being asserted in private. The last thing I'll say on this is, I really think that everyone in this country should watch Barbara Lee's speech in 2001, less than a week after 9/11, when Congress passed the authorization for the use of military force. Can you imagine what it would have been like to be the only member of Congress at that moment in U.S. history to stand up and actually say, no, we cannot start on this path because it will have no end? And she was trembling when she gave that speech. And I think it was one of the most epic speeches of this era. And in retrospect, Barbara Lee was totally right about where this was going. And she actually had the vision to see. And I think that I think she should be given a lot of credit for being that lone voice, the way that Russ Feingold was the one senator to vote against the Patriot Act. It's tough. It's tough to stand up and be principled when someone like Obama is in office. It's easy to be against war and all this criminality when Bush and Cheney are there. They're cartoonish villains. Your principles are tested when someone like Obama is in office and you have the courage to stand up and say, no, a principle is a principle, and I'm against it when a Democrat does it, and I'm against it when a Republican does it. There's no such thing as a Democratic cruise missile or a Republican cruise missile.
And if there's reason for hope here, it's that the career of Jeremy Scahill is proof that lone voices can become prominent ones. So I hope everyone here will join me in giving it up for my friend Jeremy Scahill.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thank you, Spencer.